So, last time we had introduced the definition of mod K, where K is a simplicial complex. So, today we study the topology on mod K. Before that, let me just recall what was the definition and a few notations. So, we took mod K as subset of the power set, the product set I cross I cross I taken V number of times. Number of vertices in V, whatever that many copies of I is taken, which same thing as taking functions from V to I. Additional condition that is that the support of alpha, namely points wherein alpha is not zero, they must be members of S and the sum total is equal to 1. Okay, after that, we introduce two notations for each simplex, closed simplex F, bracket, close bracket. This is all V for which its support is contained inside F. The same thing as for every V, which inside K minus F, it is 0. The second one is open simplex is all alpha in cases that alpha V is 0 if and only if V is in K minus F. That means if it's in F, it is not 0. So it's the same thing as support of alpha is equal to F. Then boundary of F was defined as closed simplex minus open simplex. Okay, so let us come to the topology now. I will first treat the finite case because it is simple, that's all. And it gives you motivation. K is finite, is same thing as V is finite. Then mod K is a subset of I cross V, number of times as many as elements of V, right? So it is a finite cube, I cross V, the finite cube. Okay. So we can just simply take the subspace topology from this I power V, which is I power N, where N is the cardinality of V. It's a familiar object for us. It's inside R power N, right? So take the induced topology, namely a subspace topology, then you call it as geometric realization of K. The geometric realization of K and denoted by mod K is not just a set. It has a topology. What is this topology? At least in the case of K is finite, it is the subspace of I power V defined in a particular way. It is a subset of I power V already. You take the subspace topology. Okay, you already noticed that this is given by a closed condition. So mod K is a closed subset of this one. In particular, it's compact. Closed subset of a compact set is compact. Okay, and each closed F is again a closed subset of mod K. Okay, that is also given by a closed condition. Okay, its conditions are all given on the coordinate functions. Okay, equal to something, intersection, several of them. So it becomes a closed set. Note that its closed simplex F as a natural convex structure coming from that of I raised to V. I raised to V is a cube, right? I cross I. That's a convex set. So that convex set, the same structure is there inside mod F, the closure of closed simplex F, and closed simplex X itself is a convex subset. Okay. For if alpha and beta are inside this closed simplex, and t is between 0 and 1, then t times alpha plus 1 minus t times beta is again an element of F. What is the meaning of this? Take this one, say this is a gamma. Gamma of V is not 0, implies that V must be inside F. If gamma of V is not 0, if gamma of V is 0, for alpha it will be 0 outside, for beta also it will be 0. So for the combination also it will be 0. right? If v is a point outside f, then this will be zero. That is why it is inside. The moment gamma of a v is zero for every v outside k minus f, or inside k minus f, outside f, then it is an element of closed simplet. We may identify a mod f with a convex subset of I raised to f. You see, I raised to f is a subset of I raised to is actually a quotient of I raised to v. Okay, because f is subset of v, you can take only those things. But this I raised to f is another copy of I cross I and so on. Okay, so there is an identification of this one also. And of course, inside that you have to again take the condition to that sum total is equal to 1. Now, what is the thing? I have just excluded all those coordinates for which this point is 0 anyway. So that is why I have taken only this part. That's all. Now comes the more interesting topology. The relative interior of closed F. A relative interior of a set inside a topology, topological space, okay, is not exactly the interior of F as a subspace of the topological space X. The relative interior, okay, has to be defined inside the space. It is a tricky thing. So this can be done for geometric things, okay? So that's what we are going to do. For example, suppose you have open interval, closed interval contained in R2, okay, as a subspace of R2, but it is inside R. In R, the closed interval has its interior, which is open interval, but as a subspace of R2, it has no interior. Okay, so this open interval is the relative interior of this mod, the simplex, irrespective of where it is contained in. So we are defining it irrespective of it. So this is what? Interior of F is precisely those alpha for which alpha v is not zero, if and if is not. This is the another notation now, which is we have already defined it as open simplex F. Now, you know why it is called open simplex F. It is the interior of mod F. So inside this bracket F, round bracket F, open F is an open subset. Okay. The boundary of F, by very definition, will be a closed subset. And that will be the union of proper things. At least one of them, one of the vertices is zero. So it is inside that proper subset, union of such things. Second point, again, I'm telling you, this closed simplex F is homeomorphic to the geometric realization of mod F, where F is thought as a simplicial complex. Given a simplex, you take all its subsets, that's a simplicial complex. Then what is the geometric realization of this? You have to take all functions defined on F, the F is a vertex set now, to I, that is why I have defined mod F as can be identified with I raised to F, with condition summation alpha equal to 1. And the first condition is automatic because every subset of F is already inside the simplicial complexes. Okay. So this mod F, this bracket F, is a subset of some simplicial complex mod K. But its geometric realization, you know, it can be identified with the geometric realization of the simplicial complex F. Each map F from F to I can be identified with the map F with alpha from V to I, which is zero outside F and yielding the same condition. Now, inside K, inside mod K, what happens to the intersection of F1 and F2? Look at F1 and F2 are two simplexes. Okay. I can talk about mod F1 and mod F2. They will be subspaces of mod K. Right? I want to say that it is precisely equal to the mod of F1 intersection F2. F1 intersection F2, if it's empty, this will be empty. Those which have supports inside F1, those which have support inside F2, if F1 and F2 are disjoint, okay, there cannot be any such element, right? They will be totally distinct things. Therefore, if this is F1 intersection empty, this is empty. But suppose this is non-empty, then this is a simplex. This is a face of both of them. This is contained in the F1, F2, it's contained both of them. And I want to say this is equal and this is very straightforward. Namely, this is point set topology. You see, just you look at what is the meaning of an element here. The support of that element is inside F1 intersection F2. So it is inside F1 as well as F2. And conversely. So the two subspace topologies on the intersection coming from F1 or coming from F2, they coincide. Okay. So this is very important, the thing we have to observe. Why? Because modulus F1, F2 is a subspace of mod K itself directly. So whether you come from F1 or come from F2, it must be the same thing. All right. So the family of closed subsets, mod F, or you can write it as now bracket F, closed bracket F, what mod F, they are the same. Okay, so whatever tentatively I have put at bracket F is now the same thing as mod F. I said F is a face of K. As soon as it's a face of K, it's a closed subset. Look at all these. That's a family of closed subsets. Okay. Everything in K must belong to one of them. That's by definition. Every element of mod K has support one of the faces. So this is a cover for mod K. But it's not an open cover, it's a closed covering. But it is finite because K itself is finite, I have taken. Okay. Clearly, G contained inside mod K, take any set. It will be closed if and only if G intersection mod F is closed in mod F for every F in K. Okay, this is the property of any finite closed covering for a topological space. It's an elementary property. How you define a continuous function on two closed sets, continuous on each of them, and on the intersection they agree. Automatically, it's continuous on the whole space. So this is true for finite covers which are closed. On each of them, if you verify continuity, and on the intersections, the functions agree that function is defined on the whole of it, then it will be automatically continuous, right? So it's the same thing as saying that G intersection mod F is closed for every F, if and only if G is closed. So this has the standard wording here, namely, it is a weak topology with respect to the above covering. If you have forgotten your point set topology. This property gives us an idea how to get a good topology on mod K when K is infinite. So this property is going to be our guiding principle for defining a topology when K is infinite. Okay. So that is K is not finite. So let me complete this one. Let V be an infinite set and K is always a subset of I raised to V. It's a closed subset of I raised to V. Okay, by definition. You can put the following metric now. First, I will put a metric on on this mod k. Of course, it will be from I raised to v. For I raised to v, v is too big. So I don't want to put a metric on that. All right. What is it? Take any two elements alpha and beta. Alpha will look like a finite sum alpha I vi, right? Because alpha is not zero. This alpha is nothing but alpha of vi, right? We have seen that it's a ith coordinate, vi-th coordinate function. That's the meaning of this one. And that is not zero only finitely many. Similarly, beta is a finite combination like this. Okay. So this is just a tentative notation. If you identify vi with an element of mod k, how do you do that? It is vi operating upon vi is is 1, and vi operating upon vj is 0. Right? So that is the element. These are the standard basis elements for I raised to v. Okay, so in that sense, this summation makes sense. Okay, summation beta vi belonging to mod k, we know that alpha I and beta I are 0 except for finitely many I, which is same thing as that these two are finite sums. Okay, then I can define distance between alpha and beta to be just the square root of the sum of the squares of the differences. Just like in the Euclidean space. Take the coordinate functions, take the differences, take the square of that, take the sum, and then take the square root. This makes sense because only for finitely many i's, these are non-zero. No, I raised to v, I can't do that because this is too huge. Then infinitely many coordinates may be non-zero. Okay, so for mod k, I can do that because mod k is contained inside I raised to v for which. So this makes sense. It's direct verification, just like in a direct sum of vector spaces. This will become a metric. Okay, and we have a metric topology. If its k is finite, this is just the Euclidean metric in R raised to n, because all those things I have to involve now. Okay, so whatever topology we have done, we have analyzed for k finite, that is metric topology only from Euclidean space. All right, but we are using a different property of that space, and then we will have to do this one. This metric topology on infinite thing is not a good thing for us. So we will modify it. Okay, let us denote this mod k with the metric topology kd, suffix d, because we are not finally interested in this one. This is only a intermediate step. Clearly, it coincides with the Euclidean topology when V is finite. Therefore, the topology induced on each mod F from mod KD is the same as the Euclidean topology that we have been taking, namely of the simplexes and so on. That's what we have done so far. Okay. For each mod K, for each mod F, the topology that we have defined using an isomorphism, using a homeomorphism of this one with a standard simplex, that topology is the same as the subspace topology from KD. Now I want to redefine the topology and the whole of K by declaring a subset of A, subset A of K is closed if and only if A intersection F is closed for every F. So this property which we have verified for when k is finite, this becomes the defining property for the topology. A subset is closed if and only if intersection with each f is closed. So this is the weak topology with respect to the family of closed subsets. Clearly, then this topology is finer than KD. If A is already closed inside KD, then A intersection F will be closed inside KD as well as in mod F, because mod F has the same subspace topology from KD. So all closed subsets of KD are inside this topology, weak topology. This is a funny name. This is called weak topology for some different reason. But with respect to this KD, it is stronger than the topology of KD, because everything closed subset inside KD is already closed here. It's a finer topology than KD. The metric topology has certain properties. The mod K is even better. It has more open sets. Okay, so one good reason for taking this weak topology, I have put it in a bracket, because this is not weaker than mod KD, but it's actually finer. Instead of the metric topology, is that constructing continuous functions on K becomes simpler and is coherent with our theme that the simplices are the building blocks of simplicial complex. So this is the motivation. I will restate it as a theorem. Take any topological space X. Okay. Or A. Again, this X should be Y. Okay, take any topological space Y. A function from mod K to Y is continuous if and only if restriction map of F to mod F to Y is continuous for every F. What is F? F is a simplex in K. We write this one all the time. Instead of writing K is equal to V, comma S, it is actually for every F inside S, the simplex. Okay. Likewise, a function from mod K cross I to Y is continuous if and only H restricted to each mod F cross I is continuous for every phase F in K. Okay. The first one is actually same as definition of the topology on mod K. Right? Take a subset here which is closed. Its inverse image is closed here is what I want to show. The inverse image here is nothing but F inverse of F restricted to F inverse of that set. Okay, by definition, if this is closed, but if this is closed for every F, then that is closed because this is the weak topology. And conversely, okay, this is fine. But now, same thing is claimed for the product. For this, careful proof of this one has to be written down, and that uses function space topology. Okay, to prove the second part, first part I have done, we note that I is locally compact. In fact, I is compact, right? Whenever locally compact host or space, I can use the exponential correspondence theorem, right? So I'm just recalling the exponential correspondence theorem. If X is locally compact, Y and Z are any topological spaces, the exponential map E from Y power X cross X to Y given by E of Fx is continuous, and any function from any topological space Z to Y power X is continuous if and only if E composite G cross I identity is continuous. So these two theorems, this was part A, part B, and so on of that exponential correspondence theorem. So I use now x to be the closed interval 0, 1 because that is locally compact, right? So put x is I and z as k. Then you can define g from this k mod k to this y raised to I. Y is arbitrary space. By the formula, gz must be a function from I to y to be h of zt. Remember, h is given from mod k cross I to y. So first coordinate is in mod k and second coordinate is in I. Then to take E composite G cross identity, that will be precisely H. That is the definition. Hence, H is continuous if and only if G is continuous by the exponential correspondence. Now, G is continuous from the first part applied to Y power G if and only if G restricted to each mod F is continuous for every mod F inside K, right? Which is same thing as, now go back to exponential correspondence. This G restricted to F is continuous if and only if E composite G cross I restricted this one, which is same thing as H of F restricted to I, H restricted to mod F cross I is continuous. So exponential correspondence is used, first go to the power here and then come back, both. Both sides you have to, if you know this part has to be used. We will stop here. Next time we will study maps between simplicial complexes. What kind of maps we have to study there, okay? Thank you.